Hello, everybody. This is Filmmaking with Noobs, and we are the Romantics.
Welcome.
And today we're going to talk a little bit about our last episode that we put out, season 2, episode 2 of the Romantics, called Donuts. And we're going to talk about some of the major, major problems we had. We had to reshoot a couple of scenes, and we had some color and lighting issues again.
Ugh.
Which we've been dealing with throughout the entire series as Aaron is learning the camera and the ways of the DSLR. So we're going to talk about that, and then we're going to eventually move on to some responding to some questions that we saw on YouTube from you guys and some answers to our questions. And we'll probably end up talking about those for a while because there's some stuff about authors and comic books. And I know Dan is really excited about talking comic books a little bit today. And hopefully...
it's who I am.
hopefully the rest of us can keep up. I know that I don't know a whole lot about comics, but I can talk about comic book stuff.
Sure. So I can keep up for the first couple miles, and then and my nipples will start to bleed, and I'll have to bow out.
Oh, my God.
That's not true.
You're going to strap up before
don't
you
wear
do
it. Yeah, aren't you supposed to put like a piece of electrical tape over your nipples?
Two little X's. Yeah.
Is it like all those little red
girls? Electrical tape?
I don't know.
No, it's Band-Aids.
Oh.
It's no, dude.
Band-Aids pulls hair.
Would hurt. Band-Aids pull
electrical
hair.
Tape isn't very sticky.
It's it does, Band-Aids.
Electrical tape, when it's only sticky when it sticks to itself. So if you put it on your skin, it just kind of...
That's why you gag your part. That's why they gag people on TV.
Did you say? What I think he's,
that's why they like, gag people on TV with electrical tape.
That sounded like that's why you gag your partner.
Let's move on, folks.
Okay.
And into the conversation of bedroom talk.
Okay,
oh my
so
gosh.
So
I'm just talking about TV.
So the first, we're going to start off talking a little bit about the previous episode, Donuts, which I feel Aaron sent me this, or he uploaded it to YouTube. The way we normally do it is when we're done with everything and Aaron's got the sound and stuff for me, he goes home, edits everything, and then usually the night before, sometimes the day of, depends on how much time we have. He uploads it to YouTube from his house, and then I get on YouTube and edit all the metadata and all that kind of stuff. And then we post it at 6 p.m. And this time when he put it up on YouTube, I always watch it first, you know, and double check some things, make sure the sound is right. There's nothing really glaring that he can change last minute real easy so we don't put out something crummy. And I went and watched it. And I got extremely excited when I watched it because I immediately felt like it was the best episode that we've ever done. And so tooting our own horns a little bit, it just felt like a little bit like all of the work that we've been putting in, like and stuff that we've been learning about everything just kind of came together a little better in that one. Now, that's not saying it doesn't still have problems because it does. We're working on that. I mean, there's only four of us total. So, and Aaron's doing six jobs in one on this thing. So the main thing that I posed to Aaron that I thought was still a major issue is the brightness. The sunlight giving us the blown out look on people and our characters. The characters were better this time because we used a scrim gem to block the sun,
which is it's a light diffuser. It's a big soft screen. I made mine out of flag material and PVC and Velcro.
Yeah.
It's a 5x5. You hold it up and you're able to block or cut down light. And
right. So it's basically a square made out of like what inch or 3/4 inch PVC
yeah.
with elbows on it. And then you use Velcro, you sew Velcro to the flag material and then strap the Velcro around the PVC pipe. And then it's this big thing that hardly any of us but Aaron can hold up because he's taller than everybody else.
Yeah, we just snap into a scrim gym.
And the wind catches it like a kite, you know, every time. So
you said that, but Vincent's tiring. Typically the one holding that thing.
Yeah, Vincent has to hold it a lot.
It's extremely difficult.
It's like a kite because you always have to hold it on the bottom to get it up high enough to block people. But yeah. That helped on the characters. So we didn't really have a lot of blown out characters this time, but we still had a lot of really badly blown out backgrounds.
Okay, so I was panicking with that. I knew that I needed stronger ND filters, neutral density filters that I bought.
And what are those?
It's a little lens attachment. It goes on the end of the lens, and it cuts down light that enters the lens. So you are able to, keep your f-stops fairly, I guess, it's always backwards. I'm never sure. I want to shoot with a wide open aperture to get depth of field. And putting an ND filter on the lens helps me control the amount of light that goes in there. A wide open aperture makes lets lots of light come in. And so to get the depth of field, you constantly having to like try to find that balance between blown out shots and, you know, the bokeh that you want or the blurriness in the background. And so,
yeah, when you see, when you guys see something for people that don't know, when you, this is something I can say, cause I'm, you know, I don't know all the stuff Aaron knows about the stuff at all, but you just kind of pick some of it up as you go along through the stuff. But when he says bokeh, that basically means your foreground, like your subject is clear and in focus. And then you have that blurred effect and effect behind them. So anything that's behind them is blurred out, and there's different levels of bokeh. There's shallow depth of field. And
yeah. If you watch the show Wilfred, they do lots of close-up shots where the depth of field is so shallow that you can only see like the eyes and the nose in focus, and then the ears and the back of the cheeks are blurred out.
So that's extremely shallow.
Yeah, it's really cool if you want to use it to show that somebody's like under some kind of
duress.
Yeah, or they're like drunk or, you know, high or something.
Right.
It's a really cool effect.
I'm really glad that you're explaining this to us, because this entire time I thought that bokeh was a style of taco.
It's pronounced bake.
Oh, okay.
I thought it was a character one of your jokes in Mortal Kombat.
Get over here.
Oh my gosh. These, so far, none of these jokes landed with me.
No.
Man, I don't know if
mine didn't land with anybody. So.
I don't know if they're terrible or if I'm just not getting the references.
There's no reference.
Uh-huh. And they were bad.
Okay. Okay. So yeah, we, in that one shot where we're both looking at the map, we had the sun hitting us directly in the face, blasting everything, like making everything extremely bright and blown out, even with just like your regular naked eyes, you had to squint. And so my ND filter wasn't strong enough to bring the light down enough. I was having to turn my f-stops down to like f11 or f12. And at that point, I just found out that there is, I'm going to mess the term up, but I think it's not difference. I don't know what the term is, but basically you lose contrast after a certain point. Like there's a sweet spot on all lenses as far as f-stops go for maximum contrast and clarity. And for the 50 millimeter Canon lens that I'm using, the f1.4, your sweet spot is like, I think it's a 3.5 to f9, I believe. And that's where you get your best clarity. And so anyway, I was losing clarity. I was bringing my foreground and background together, so everything was in focus. I didn't get any kind of separation. And so we used a scrim gym to get the lighting right on ourselves, you and me, Wes. And the background was just yellow as hell.
Right.
There's no amount of color correcting that I could do to fix that problem.
Yeah, because that's the question that somebody was asking me. They were asking me about if we wanted some links for like, to get our monitors calibrated right for color correcting and stuff, because Aaron uses a Dell IPS panel for his editing and it probably needs a little color correction done to it. But that doesn't really matter, because we've had so many problems in the Texas sun,
right,
getting the kind of raw video that even would benefit from color correcting anyway.
Yeah. Hold on just a second. I'm gonna step from the mic. Set this right there for just a second. So I got on, I signed up for a forum. I think it's divxuser.com.
That's it.
What?
That's it.
Oh, okay. So I signed, I registered.
That's it.
I registered for the forum, divxuser. It's a great forum. Get lots and lots of feedback, tons of tutorials on there to learn how to do this stuff. But it took me a week and a half to get approved. And so in the meantime, I was needing to ask a question. And so I got on Reddit's, I got on the subreddit, filmmaking or filmmakers, and asked why was our shot, or why are we having so much trouble? What can I do with ND filters to fix this problem? And then somebody brought up that, that sweet spot on all the lenses. I had, in all my research, I had not come across that. And I feel a little bit embarrassed about that.
Well, so, I mean, that's like a thing that I don't think anybody would ever know unless someone told you, because that, you would think you get a lens that says it's this to this,
yeah,
and if you use it, it should work the same.
Would each lens like depend on the camera stuff? Like you had the DSLR you have, would that, if you have this DSLR and then this filter, would that be a certain sweet spot, and then another camera, and then that same filter would be another sweet spot, or is it
no,
just from the filters?
So it's just the lens.
It is just the lens on in this instance. Cameras. I use the T3i or the 600D, the Canon. and the Canon 5D II or Mark II is a definite better image quality, but the lens is really, it's kind of the best way of controlling all that.
So is it accurate to say that the camera just captures what the lens sees?
Yeah, basically.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, my Canon is going to add, like, I'm not able to crank the ISOs up very high. I always keep my ISO under 400. A lot of people keep it under 8.
What's the ISO do?
ISO adds light to your image. It brightens it up. But
basically, it opens up the sensor, right? Or allows more of the sensor to receive information or something like that?
Honestly, I'm not exactly sure how the ISO works. I knew at some point.
Now, my understanding was that higher ISO gives your Canon more damage. but what you're saying is making me think that maybe that's not true. Maybe that's not the best approach to DPSing with a Canon.
Yeah, you would think the ISO would be the best way to approach damage with a Canon, but it's more of a blunderbuss. I'm just kind of packing any random crap I find in there, and it spreads it around.
If it's too high, what it actually damages is your quality,
right?
The quality of your shot. Okay.
Yeah.
So higher.
Dan was saying something about the lens. Is it the lens that basically the camera sees basically what the lens sees? I was going to say DSLRs for people who are the difference. What's different about a DSLR from other cameras is a DSLR is basically a giant box that holds a sensor. So DSLRs are mirrorless cameras. So when light comes in, which is all an image is light to begin with. So when light comes in, light reflected light, when it comes in through the lens, it basically just hits a bare sensor. There's nothing else there. And that sensor, I think yours is APS-C sensor, which is like a 1/3 or something like
that. It's a cropped sensor. It's not a full frame sensor like the Mark III.
Without getting too technical, that has something to do with like image quality and how big the image can be,
right?
Et cetera. So.
So basically what this all boils down to, higher ISO adds more noise to the image, so you get more fuzzies. What this all boils down to is with the info I got from our filmmakers, I picked myself up some extra ND filters, a different brand, a higher strength, and I got two of them so I can stack them.
And an ND filter basically is just a thing that goes on the end of the
lens. Yeah, it's a thing that cuts down the light.
Yeah, it's just a little thing that goes on the end of the lens.
It's like sunglasses, right?
It is sunglasses,
yeah,
yes.
Basically the same thing.
And yeah, the brand I got is supposed to be one of the best brands you can get. It doesn't add any kind of color change to the image, or it's not supposed to. So you just get light reduction. And so with that, some of the softness of that, that shot.
The dreamy look.
Yeah, the look on us, it looked like we were painted in pastels or something. That also is due to the scrimgeum, the diffuser we were using. It softens the light and reduces contrast.
Right.
So we get a very soft image. So the way we're going to help control that is with the ND filters. We're not going to worry about blocking out as much light on our subjects. I mean, we'll still use that thing definitely, but we are going to let the subject in the background be lit evenly. And we will use this thing I just picked up. It's a 5-in-1 reflector. So it's got different color. And for people that can't see it,
hold it up a little bit. And if you guys want to see what he's talking about, you can just go look at the YouTube. And the YouTube is youtube.com/theromanticswb.
So yeah, it's a 5-in-1 reflector. It's got a silver, gold, white side on it.
And for people that only listen to this and stuff, it basically looks like a giant version of the sunscreen things you put in your car window.
Right. It's just a big round circle.
Except you can unzip it and it's got other stuff inside it.
Yeah. It's also got a diffuser on there. But it's got a white bounce surface too. So we're going to be able to control light this time. We're going to get an extra we're going to get an extra person out there. We'll be able to position our subjects and bounce light onto them to get the best possible image. It's going to take us a little bit more time to get used to it, but I think that we will be able to eliminate all of those blown out scenes that we've had in the past.
That's kind of what Justin was using for pen and paper and stuff, right?
That looks like the exact same thing, actually. Yeah. This might be a little bigger, but that's about the same thing.
I thought that it was, because in case of equipment, I don't know who owns what all the time.
Yeah. Justin is the film guy, the camera guy that is shooting Aaron's other project.
Yeah, he's the co-director and DP on pen and paper.
And he's professional. He knows what he's doing. We're still learning.
He's not new to video, but he's still learning video.
Yeah, he's a photo guy.
Yeah, he does still photography. He does.
And I think he uses a, 5D Mark II?
Yeah, he does. I think last time I talked to him, he's getting ready to upgrade to the Mark III.
But it sounds like a lot of the same principles apply to still photography as I would like.
Yeah, tons of it does.
Yeah, there's just a few small differences that I can't even really remember right now at this point. But yeah, it's all about light control. That's what it kind of boils down to. So yes, the next episode should have no scene that's blown out. We're also going to bring a laptop along so we can pop in and check footage that we might find questionable.
Yeah, I explained on my stream the other day when somebody was asking, we had like 300 people in there, and somebody was asking a question about that. And I told them that the one of the major problems that we also have is the inability to check the stuff on location. We're always on location somewhere, like at a park or, you know, down some street somewhere. And it takes too much time to like run back to the house, pop an SD card in, look at the video. Because I was explaining on the Canon T3i, the LCD screen on there that you use to monitor everything, it doesn't have a viewfinder. It just has the LCD screen.
They make those that you can pop on the back. But
right. But so yeah, it's still the same problem. It's very tiny, first of all. It doesn't show accurate colors as to what you're recording. And it's also not even 720p. It's like lower than that. I can't remember what the resolution on is, but it's very not good. And so because of
to
that...
To be professional.
Yeah. For the technical term, it's very not good. And so the problem that causes is with a lot of cameras, when you start getting more serious with them, DSLRs, you buy the shoulder rig, you buy the monitor that mounts onto it, and the monitors are usually anywhere from like a 4-inch to a 7-inch screen that you mount that's like full 1080p, shows you what your output is going to look like. It's accurate. You can't do that with the Rebel T3i.
That's got to be hella expensive.
You can, but it won't output. It'll output exactly what the LCD screen sees,
right?
Which is wrong. So, they only make one monitor for the T3i that can output the color corrected normal looking version, and it costs like $750.
I think I read something about the Magic Lantern firmware that helps fix that.
Oh, maybe so. I don't know about that.
That's also something we're doing. I'm kind of nervous to do that because it adds crazy tons of options to the menus. It's a firmware that you can download and install onto your camera. You happen to void your warranty when you do that, but it's also extremely reliable. Most people do it.
Maybe you should do that in the off season and practice with it. I don't know. I don't know what the options are like. Only you can figure that out.
Yeah, I don't think I'll do it for tomorrow, but I think the following episode I will have it ready. It just makes it more flexible. Gives you some monitoring options for in the field, like so you can monitor your light and your...
Yeah, that's the other thing that we're kind of ignoring when we say this kind of stuff. There are ways to use your camera's LCD screen and look at the graphs for color and white balance and stuff. And you can make your stuff right doing that. But I think because Aaron has never done this before, that's a thing that takes a long time to learn how to do properly.
Right.
Yeah. And so that still causes the same problem for us. Well,
yeah, like individually it's easy to learn. But like when it's all together and I'm having to worry about all these different little things, some things just, you know, kind of fall through the cracks. Yeah. So lighting will be better for the next episode. I want to cover the next big issue that we had was simply just kind of being exhausted. Like we were all tired. We all got sun exhaustion.
We all got wicked bad sunburn. In fact, since that day, I think Vince and I at least have been referring to the sun as Incinerus, the Lord of hatred.
Yeah, well, actually, since the first episode, because I got something really bad. It's the first, I actually have like a nice little...
Farmer's tan,
yeah.
Yeah, same here.
From the first episode. So learning from that, the next one, I was quick to put on sunscreen.
I looked like the Hound for a week. It was bad.
Did you have like the missing hair and stuff too?
Well, I'm
just singed it off.
I'm working on it.
Going to bed.
Yeah, it was exhausting.
Not really. I have excellent jeans.
They are nice. Kohl's? JCPenney?
Are they diesel jeans?
That's not what I was talking about, but I will accept Vincent's compliment.
Okay.
They're from Target.
Target. Very nice.
Indeed.
It's French.
So each one of us got exhausted for different reasons. I got exhausted because trying to swing swing set while delivering lines turned out to be way tougher than I thought it would be. Then we all just kind of like were standing around getting baked without having any sunscreen.
It's so baked.
And then I want to, Dan,
we were not doing that.
No.
It's Dan, too much work to be done.
Do you feel comfortable talking about the scene in the car?
I'll talk about anything.
Yeah, you know, tell us a little bit about that.
Ooh.
We'll
talk about anything.
The scene with Dan in the car, which is my favorite part of that episode.
What? We're talking about donuts, right?
Yeah, donuts.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, in that episode or shooting that, what are some of the difficulties you encountered?
Wait, what are not some of the difficulties?
Yeah, that might be a short list.
I'll answer Aaron's question first. I'm an idiot. and I don't have any hand mouth coordination. So we were basically, and I'm sure that most of the people who are listening to this or have seen it have, or who are watching it have seen the episode by now. But basically I'm sitting in the front seat of the car, driving around a neighborhood, having a conversation with Lippy, who is in the back seat, behaving himself really well.
Mm-hmm.
At least at first.
Trying to.
At least at first.
Yeah. I'm a bad kid.
We'll see. We'll see what happens and how I decide to deal with you.
If you would have read the script, you might have known.
So, sorry, guys. What the viewer at home doesn't see is that Aaron is next to me holding... He's resting his hand in my lap with a giant furry microphone,
basically,
aimed at my face, and
right between his arms, and his steering wheel sticking up through there.
And Wes is in the back operating the camera, so there's four of us.
No, Wes is in the back monitoring the audio.
Oh, right, yeah.
Monitoring. I'm holding the camera.
Aaron is doing the camera and the mic. Yeah.
Aaron's doing everything.
No.
Aaron has Shiva arms.
It was packed in. It was very packed in the car, and we were limited to what we could do.
It was hot.
The Pontiac Grand Am is a lot more grand on the outside than it is on the inside.
Yeah, I was surprised, actually.
It was wicked hot, and because of the position of the microphone and just the quality of our sound equipment, and which isn't bad, but I mean just what we're set up for, air conditioning was a tremendous problem. And so
it always is.
It was probably about 90 degrees outside. Is that safe?
So it was in the high 80s, I think.
Okay. In the car, I would estimate it was about 102 degrees.
I think it was more than that in there.
And
it was like 120 in the back seat.
We were unable to run the air conditioner. And we're hearing every little bump in the road. And Wes can speak more to why that would be. But
that was more irritating than it turned out to actually be.
Well, that's good. Yeah.
Poor city planning and terrible drought.
Yeah, we were driving over those concrete slabs that have the cracks in them going da-dunk, 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 and a rhythm. And I could hear all of it. I thought it was just ruining all the sound.
Yeah, that was fine.
The issue that I was having was that every time I would take a turn, I would be unable to continue speaking.
Yeah.
And then because of that, because of being flustered by that, unable to remember my line or deliver my line. And so what we wound up doing is for the dialogue part, just driving like down the same strip at about 5 miles an hour and just doing nothing. But
I have a comment about that.
Uh-oh.
It was supposed to be about 5 miles an hour, but every time we would start, like as soon as we actually didn't figure out, I don't think we realized that the dialogue was getting screwed up on the turns until we'd already done it about 20 times. And then it was like, oh, you know what? Every time there's a turn that happens. And so then we were able to sort of correct for that. But we were like, Dan, slow down.
Yeah, if you want to know how fast we were going, just look in Dan's sunglasses at the car.
It was more like 35 to 40.
We really don't want people to pick the show apart this much. Yeah. I'm pretty sure.
The streets were so short that, and then the little paragraph was long enough to where it's like, we'd get like three-fourths of the way through.
Turns
yeah, like three-fourths of the way through. And then as we turn, you'd mess up. So we had to start from the beginning. And then it would just do that same cycle over and over and over.
The thing that I had a problem with, the two things that I was having a problem with, as far as that happening, like now that we know that that's happening, the issues that I was having were, one, this was some of my favorite dialogue in the episode, and certainly my favorite dialogue that my character has. And so I was really frustrated that it was getting screwed up because I was really enjoying, like, I was reading over it, and it was hilarious when I, you know, the previous couple of days.
Thanks.
And then, you know, just it was really hard to not be as funny as I wanted that to be, because I kept screwing up the scene. And then also, going beyond that, the fact that it was, yeah, I lost my train of thought completely just then. I was trying to BS it, but it didn't pan out. There was a second thing that I wanted to say, but I think I was going through those turns in my mind and it derailed me.
Yeah. You were making a turn and it just ended.
Well, if we have time sometime, I'll show you that sequence that I edited and all my notes that I made.
I'm okay. That's okay.
It's actually your first two takes. I got all my stuff out of. And
really?
Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
You think you did.
Used.
Yeah. You think you did a lot worse than you did. There was a line you did in there and the intent, but you did not mean, I don't think you meant to deliver the line this way. The line was, and maybe pick up some used towels for me.
Yes.
But the look on your face with the take from the take that I actually used, it looked like I'm trying to remember back to that take, and I think you were like unsure of what the line was or something. But
it came out. It came out looking ultra serious. Like
it was one of the funniest things I've ever seen.
That's not the one you used though.
Yeah, it's a shot where you were like,
because I think in the. I delivered that line so many times, and I only watched the episode once. But yeah. I think when I actually say the line, it's like por favor.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, that part of it.
So it's the look on your face, like you're kind of exposing a real piece of yourself, and it's nasty. And you're trying you see his reaction, and you quickly pull back and you change your mind on it. But it's right. So fun. I laughed six times in a row.
Wait, my wife laughed four times during that scene.
Well, I figure, I mean, you're going to like harvest whatever footage you want from these takes. So I try to deliver the things that if I'm not 100% sure about it, or if I think it has the potential to do more than one thing, I try to do it a little bit differently each time.
Yeah. Yeah. I appreciate that. That's what, I mean, I think that's what you're supposed to do.
I have no idea what I'm supposed to do. I just do.
I don't either. Slow down, Dan. That's what you're supposed to do. Slow the car down.
So next time.
I started getting a little worried because there were so many cars on the streets. That made it hard, too. And yeah. The one street that you kept having to go out onto was actually a street that had cars on right. It sometimes. So you'd pull out in the middle of a line, and there'd be a car, and you'd have to stop and wait. And it was like, oh, yeah, we got to do this over again.
How much trouble can we get in for this, like revealing that this is how we do this? I mean,
I don't think it's against the law to talk lines while driving a car.
Unlimited trouble.
It may be sort of frowned on. But
I know it's severely frowned upon. But man,
you gotta do what you gotta do. We don't have sets or money.
Yeah.
Yep.
Also, the tags on my car expired, and so I was terrified.
We saw a cop.
Yeah,
there was a cop.
We were fairly certain he was there to see what we were.
We drove
up to.
By a guy watering his grass like 400 times, and I think that guy probably called the cop.
That shirtless guy.
Yeah.
What do you call him, Dennis?
It's Dennis the shirtless guy.
He waved at us the first two times that we went by, and then after that,
nobody waved back.
He stood there with his fists on his hips.
Oh my gosh!
What are these boys
I'm
doing?
I'm glad I couldn't see that.
Who are these rapscallions?
If those boys keep whacking off of my truck.
Yeah, because really, we just drove in a circle for 45 minutes.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
And it was awful.
In the intense, extreme heat.
It was my favorite part of the episode, though.
Yeah, and we got a lot of comments about that being people's favorite part of that whole episode.
Really?
Yeah. They really loved the dialogue in there.
It was funny, and I really like, because there's so much opportunity in that episode for... One thing I'm most impressed about with Vincent is that
okay.
This is my favorite part of the podcast. He has so much range and nuance of expression. And I've said this to you before, but we were talking at the end of the episode. Can we talk about the episode? Because it's out.
I mean, Yeah. Okay. Say whatever you want.
So at the end of the episode, Vincent makes a decision. And the decision is to run away, and it's or Lipton does, and it's the best decision anyone's ever made in the show. And before we went and shot it, we were standing in the driveway. Or no, actually, it was after the first time that we shot it, because we went back and reshot that scene.
The next day?
We didn't reshoot the runaway, but
we reshot his face.
Yeah, the
he
face.
Stood there.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Because he was talking to me about how he wanted to deliver it, And he gave me examples of like the two different ways that he did deliver it on camera, and then the two like superior options. And there are all these like tiny variations of like eyebrow and lip.
It's like watching a wine master taste some kind of
It's unbelievable. He really does have a distinct talent, and it's pretty amazing. And so one of my favorite things about that scene is that I say these just preposterous, crass, awful things, which are not unlike things that I would say in real life, but I would hope that people would understand that I was kidding.
Yeah.
And then to see his reactions to those things makes it so much more satisfying than, you know, if it was just a monologue, like you have this jerk off in the front seat, just like,
Chief, buddy.
Yeah. Just like saying these terrible things. Lipton's reactions are amazing. Yeah. And they really kind of compound. Like that's how you punctuate each one of those jokes. And
speaking of that, in the car scene, the expressions between both of you guys that Aaron edited in made that scene. Like when you say the thing about the towels and he's like, what? And then you have this look on your face. And you're like, oh, you can keep whatever souvenirs. He's like,
just gets quiet.
And then you kind of just stare for a second.
I was really happy with what I was able to do while wearing sunglasses. See, when we did, I do really like, what was the first episode of season two called?
Breakfast. Hotcakes.
Hotcakes.
Did you say breakfast?
That's what we did.
That's every episode. Breakfast / hotcakes.
Breakfast with the romantic.
Well, the third one's not going to be a breakfast food. Sorry.
Damn it.
Well, because we're getting later in the day.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Thank you. That's perfect.
But then at night, it's back to IHOP.
No, what were we saying?
Hotcakes, breakfast. You're glad what you're getting sunglasses.
No, I like that scene, and I like what the two of us were able to do, but I felt like, you know, it takes a while for, I think, people to get, this is my first, well, my second, I guess, but it's my first, like, completed experience in acting. I don't know if everybody
getting to do it and then see that.
Right, because Dan is also in pen and paper briefly.
Right. And
briefly.
Well, briefly as in he's not doing anything for it right this minute.
Like, oh, yes.
I give a lot of disapproving looks.
Yeah, Dan's the look master.
But I think it gets, you have to get comfortable enough because, you know, actors are supposed to immerse themselves in the character and just feel what the character is feeling and then react to it.
Yeah.
And that's how you act. At least that's my understanding of how the process works.
I've been doing it wrong.
And it, yeah, no, I mean,
shit. I was just going out this all the wrong way.
I'm offended by your use of profanity, first of all. Second of all,
he's not.
Yeah, I'm really not. That's what I wanted to do when we shot Hotcakes, but. Like
the
I see my face, and I know that I was obviously like just trying to pick out the right way to deliver lines and do it, and I was not very expressive with some of the things that I'm delivering dialogue. My face takes up the whole camera, or it takes up the whole frame, and in Donuts, I felt like I was so much more comfortable, even though we did all that reshooting in the car, or we shot so many takes in the car. I felt like I was so much more comfortable just trying to, you know, just be Dan.
Well, while you were getting irritated doing that, I mean, even though you were getting irritated, it was better than it was the first time because you just kept trying to do the line and, you know, and previously you were always constantly self-conscious about, I'm going to be terrible, I'm going to suck, you know, kind of stuff because you've never done it before. That's the way we all felt the first
self-fulfilling
time.
Self-fulfilling prophecy?
Yeah. So, no, that didn't happen, but. Yeah, maybe you can make it be that way if you thought about it too much, but...
you have my guarantee. Next episode, I will suck.
So, Vincent, we got about a couple more minutes on this topic. You got anything you want to add about any problems or issues you experienced in the last episode?
I don't think so.
Your name's not Vincent, or...
We are
one. I had a question. I was trying to think of a question together.
Are you guys mind-melded?
We're trying. Yeah, I was going to say Vincent...
Vincent didn't have as much stuff in this episode, seems like.
He had like two or three lines.
Yeah, it was largely visual.
I mean, he was in it, a lot, but not as many lines. So mostly sunburn.
Yeah, that's pretty much about it.
Actually, I actually thought his scene where he ran and stuff was pretty badass.
Yeah.
Well,
it turned out to look really, really good in the end.
The stuff we're going to have to shoot tomorrow.
Oh.
I just want to apologize for it.
Don't reveal anything
yet. It's okay.
I mean, it's obvious. I'm not going to say anything.
I went to the gym last night and prepared for it.
Okay. So.
I didn't do that.
I think that'd be pretty good.
Yes. In the next episode, Vincent is going to bench press Aaron.
Yep.
No, I was
man. Spoiler alert or something. You're going to have to edit that.
When I was there, I was trying to gauge how well I'll be able to do tomorrow. I think I'll be okay.
We will try to be smart about it. We will try.
All right. Let's go ahead and move on to something else here. We asked some questions last week. We asked people what their favorite authors were. And so we're going to go over some of the responses that we got on YouTube and talk about that for a few minutes. The first one was from Mud, or My Name is Mud on YouTube.
My Name is Mud.
And he named some of his favorite authors, Terry Pratchett, and he said he likes his tongue-in-cheek style. Anybody got anything to say about Terry Pratchett?
I love Terry Pratchett. The only thing I've actually completed of his is Night Watch, though, but it was awesome.
I've only read, I can't think of the name of it. The one with Tia Timey in it. What's that one called? With the Grim Reaper and all that kind of stuff in it.
The Grim Reaper shows up in the Hog Watch.
Hogfather.
Hogfather.
Yes.
Is that the one you read?
I think it is the Hogfather. It's the one with it's the first film that had Tia Timey in it. It was on Netflix. I watched that, and then I read that book, and then I watched the other film that has Sean Astin in it.
That's it's the one with the wizard.
Where he comes from Morpork or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And he's got the walking chest with all the gold in it and all that stuff. I really like him. I like the whole weird intro, the setup for all that, and what Discworld actually is pretty funny to me.
I'm really typically not a fan of slapsticky, insane comedy, but I think Terry Pratchett pulls it off really well.
You're not?
No. I like Dumb and Dumber. I will watch that any day of the week, but I can't watch.
I can quote that movie word for word.
But I can't watch, Step Brothers.
My respect level just plummeted for both of you.
Well, I haven't seen that since I was, 19, but...
Feelings mutual, Dan.
Yep.
I don't care.
Oh, no.
Think I care?
Podcast over. Forever.
Okay,
so... How romantic's meaning where they just fight?
Yeah, so Terry Pratchett and Douglas Adams. Anybody got anything to say about Douglas Adams?
What is he write?
Hitchhikers.
I am ashamed. Yeah. I still have not finished.
You haven't finished that book?
No.
Wow. I read all of those when I was in high school.
I'd also like to point out he has another series about Dirk Gently's holistic detective agency.
Yes, yes.
And that I read one of those. I actually think I read the second one. It was The Long Dark Tea Time of the Soul.
I've read that one. I read it, but when I was 15 or 16, though, so I can't remember all of it. But
I think I was in high school also, and it was around the time that I read The Hitchhiker's Guide. I did not read the rest of The Hitchhiker's Guide books because it wasn't really my bag. But I loved Tea Time. I thought it was hilarious.
Yeah.
And it was really involved, and it was really wacky and wheels off. And I think a lot of authors and filmmakers today that just try to do insane, stream of consciousness, these are things that are loosely related. Go! They really
the only British.
They're really
ones do that.
it is a kind of a distinctly, largely British kind of thing. I think a lot of the wackiness in the last few years of Doctor Who is really heavily influenced. For example, is really heavily influenced by Douglas Adams. So I think he's had a big impact on our culture and literature.
All right, and let's see, Noob Gone. He said David Gimmel. We don't know who David Gimmel is. We apologize for that, but we appreciate the comment. But yeah, we haven't read David Gimmel. I think that's a WoW author, because he said Draenei series.
Draenei.
So I've only ever tried to read one World of Warcraft book, and it was about the orcs.
We are potentially embarrassing ourselves.
Yeah, I have a feeling that this is nothing like this at all.
it might not be. Well, oblivious. I mean, he said the Draenei series.
Yeah, it's the only Draenei I know of.
Maybe it's something completely different.
Is it with an I-E? E-I?
I think it's E-I, yeah.
Yeah.
Does it say they have hooves?
Draenei?
Listen to my hooves.
Draenei mage. She made a Draenei mage. is that a teen reference?
Yes.
Awesome. Greatest paladin in the world.
So let's skip over that now before we get any worse
Continued
here.
Continue to embarrass.
And then Jay Jason, who's been a longtime stream watcher, and a big supporter, he said Terry Brooks and Tolkien. So I've read Terry Brooks. I think Terry Brooks stuff is okay. I liked it better when I was younger, but I got kind of bored with the straightforward kind of dragon fantasy world that is in like every single.
Would you say that when you read them, you felt like the pacing was dragon?
Yes, a little bit. Especially since there's like 400 books.
Huh.
So, no, there's not that many, but there's a lot. But I did like them then, but I don't think I could read them now because I'm just kind of tired of fantasy novels and high magic type of fantasy novels.
Do you remember the main character of those Terry Brooks novels?
I can't remember all that stuff, man. It's, you know, I had a temporary amnesia when I was 18.
You can't blame everything on that.
Actually, I can.
Did you really?
Yeah, I did.
How do you know?
I had partial amnesia because the doctor told me.
You read Terry Brooks.
Because they asked me, because when I was 18, they asked me who the president was, and I told them Ronald Reagan. And they asked me what year it was.
I would say, I don't remember how old were you when you were 18?
That was
you're
only,
a lot older
that
than
was
me.
17,
he was 18.
That was 17 years
Get
ago.
Get out.
How old were you when you were 18? 18.
It's a joke to how old two. He was, but yeah. He kind of dragged on and everyone else started talking.
Yeah,
so.
17 years ago. It wasn't Ronald Reagan.
Right.
Ronald Reagan was when I was a little kid.
Yeah, I think I wrote Ronald Reagan a letter when he got shot, and I got a response back.
Whoa, oh, really?
From Ronald Reagan?
Yeah. It had like an embossed gold wow. presidential seal
was
on
it. Nice.
Was it covered in blood?
It wasn't. This was a little after the shooting.
That would have been interesting.
Yikes.
He didn't write it.
He was very devoted to his band.
He didn't write it from a gurney.
Thanks, little man. Yeah, he's just laying down. I got nothing better to do. Give me some mail. Okay.
Oh, little Dan. Hello, little Dan. I've just been shot, Dan. What do you think of that?
I've just been shot.
That was like a weird Bush Reagan.
Yeah, I don't know what that was.
Hybrid.
It seemed presidential though.
Senior? I don't know.
Yeah. It kind of seemed presidential.
Yeah, let's move on.
Yeah. Anyway, so yeah, so the other one was Tolkien.
And I want to know who wrote that because it sounds very familiar.
What?
Tolkien.
Yeah. I'm actually in the process right now of reading through all of them. Again,
all of
them.
The LOTRs.
Well, yeah. So I've read. Actually, I didn't read Return of the King, but I've like when I was growing up, I read Fellowship and Two Towers. But for Christmas, brother actually got me all the three.
The Silly Marian.
Yeah, you got the Silmarillion, the Hobbit, and then the trilogy, and then what was the other one? The something of
Turin. The Lost.
The Shroud.
No, yeah, nothing. That, yeah, it's something like that. It happens with a lot of the like northern part of.
Yeah, I know. I actually think I have that book in there, but I can't remember the name of it.
Yeah, I don't remember.
But I'm
in the process of that.
I can talk a little bit about Tolkien before we move on. Tolkien is probably the first fantasy novel that I ever read. That was an actual book. You know that kids don't usually read when they're real young. You normally start off with like those little kind of picture books, and then you move on to I read a chapter book, you know, kind of right.
Or men's body, woman's body.
So when I was a kid, I used to
always have that one on
everyone,
the back burner,
and everybody poops that kind of stuff. Yeah, you had a book about how to hide your food.
Oh, it was me and my veggies.
Yeah,
I was talking about that the other day.
It talked about how to hide like the food you don't want to eat on your plate. Like if you got too many peas, you can hide them under your mashed potatoes.
It was one young boy's war against his vegetables.
Right.
I think most people's favorite book at that age is a copy of Lighting the Nude, which someone has on their, some parent has on their shelf.
That's
somewhere.
What Man's Body, Woman's Body was.
Or, yeah.
You had the positions in it drawn out in ink, and it was awesome.
So my grandpa used to not get off work until like 5 or 5:30, and school let out at like 3:15. So we had a blacktop road that went down one side of my school, and right across from it was a big library, big to me. So he used to let me go over there after school. I'd just walk across when I was like 7 or 8 years old. Sometimes a teacher would take me over there.
Did you look both ways?
Yeah, there was no cars ever.
He's still here, ladies and gentlemen.
Spoiler. When I would go over there, there was these two older ladies that still, as far as I know, work there. They still work there. They've been the only two ladies that ever worked there. I think they live with each other and everything. I mean, I think it's like this familial run library kind of thing, which is kind of strange.
It's kind of neat.
Are they good looking?
No, not even close.
Well, I'm sure not anymore.
Well, they weren't when I was that age and I saw them, I thought they were like in their 70s. When I went back there at like 23 or 24 and went to the library and they were still there, they still looked like they were in their 70s.
They're feeding off the youth.
Maybe that so.
Come in from the elementary school.
They walk by and suck it up.
All the youthful hours that are spent reading instead of playing, they absorb that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, libraries are terrible for absorbing.
Absorbing.
That's it, before absorbing energy and stuff.
I failed.
They absorbed it.
Sorry, Wes, continue.
Yeah, so anyway, I started out in like the kids section, you know, because that's where my grandma would always take me. So that's kind of the only part of the library I knew was the kids section. So I'd go look through books, and they had some books in there that were like young adult kind of things. But then one day I sort of like meandered into another part of the library. And this is, to me now, it's very strange, but I just happened to see Lord of the Rings on the rack, pulled it off, looked at it, didn't have any pictures or anything, sat down and kind of read the first chapter of it and was hooked. And I was 8 and I read the entire thing, and then I went and read the rest of them. And so for me, it was my first like real, like sort of, they're not really adult, but.
When did you receive your first whooping for reading them?
They never knew about me reading those. Oh, that's okay. Why I loved going to the library, because when I was a kid, I got caught with a Dungeons and Dragons Choose Your Own Adventure book. I got a whooping and we had to burn it.
Yeah, take it out to the bonfire out in the field.
When I was a kid, I had a big talk about the demon spawn that has Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, because you know back then there was a ton of hype and like churches and stuff about kids killing themselves over their characters.
Or like hexing one another to death.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That casting spells on each other and things.
If my parents are listening to this right now, I just want you to be aware that there's nothing instructional in Dungeons and Dragons. If I wanted to hex someone to death, my tabletop role-playing experience would be useless. And I'm really a little angry with you guys for misleading me about that, because that's why I got into this, is so that I could, you know, from a distance without any kind of evidence, eliminate my enemies. And it's been pointless. And so I feel deceived by the church. I feel deceived by my parents. And just generally let down.
Yeah. Isn't that why I read Harry Potter? To get the spells and the magic and
do those work?
Just a few.
I tried it once.
I gotta go, guys. That's very
fun. I think these days it's kind of like, I think it's kind of like okay to go see that stuff now. It's like not as bad as it was.
Well, there's still people that definitely don't like it.
There is very strong like right-wing opposition to those things. I worked in bookstores for...
Maybe it's just because I'm out of that scene. I don't realize it as much.
Yeah. I don't always recognize a lot of the kind of church verbiage and things now that I'm not involved with that. But when I worked at when I worked for Barnes & Noble, there were a lot of people would actually like do sit-ins and things on Harry Potter release days. And because of fire code, you know, we only had enough room for a certain number of customers. So, but fortunately here in the state of Texas, you could ask those people to leave. But yeah, so there is, people do oppose that, but I don't think you can learn any real magic. So again, this is all pointless.
Yeah, don't believe the hype. Yeah, it's...
Did you learn any magic from Lord of the Rings? Let's tie this back into
this. I learned some magic in my mind.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Yes. I'll tell you what Lord of the Rings did for me. I had a big imagination when I was a kid anyway, because I grew up like an only child.
Right.
And I had a farm and no toys. So I spent all my time outside with a stick, you know.
Playing with cow patties.
Yeah, that's kind
of making believe that I was...
Drawing little smiley faces in the cow patties.
So making believe that I had a sword and I was slaying dragons and things, you know.
Of course.
So, I mean, that's all I did. So, but when I read Lord of the Rings, the way that Tolkien... And I really believe that people really need to understand that those books were really written for his kids. Like, he really wrote those as an imaginative tale for his kids. And that was his intent. And if you read one of those things when you're like 12 or 13 or something, the experience is completely different from when you're 30.
You're not talking about Lewis. You're talking about Tolkien.
Tolkien, yeah.
I thought he only wrote The Hobbit for his kids.
No, they were all considered like a younger, like he wanted to tell them to his kids, basically.
Oh, okay.
The other stuff that he wrote in a more serious fashion was stuff like Silmarillion. He wrote sort of in like a prose. So those things are sort of poetic, and he has tons and tons and tons of poetry out there. But he created that entire world as just like a world, you know. And then he wrote Hobbit, and The Lord of the Rings was actually just one novel originally. It was like one story, and they split it up because it was huge.
Did they originally split it into 6 parts, and then
I think it was just 3. I don't know. It's gone through so many changes in 50 years. Who knows? But yeah, the I've read almost everything the Hobbit's ever written. Hobbit's ever written. I've read everything the Hobbits have ever written. Those guys.
There and back again.
A Hobbit's Tale by a Hobbit.
Yeah, I like them, but it takes me a good year and a half to finish one. I can read a page and a half before I have to take a nap.
They're harder for me to read now, and that's what I'm saying. I think when I was a kid, those things really helped me develop sort of my love of, fiction, I guess.
I really want to take this opportunity to talk to our viewers for a minute and say that I'm really glad that we have had this chance to introduce them to J.R.R. Tolkien through this discussion, because he's an author that not a lot of people know about. And I'm really glad that through this podcast, you know, we've been able to impart a little bit of our experience so that maybe we can introduce this guy
and a little bit of this niche culture.
Yeah, and maybe get him up off the ground a little bit and kind of mainstreamed into the rest of not just that niche.
Yeah, didn't he just get his Kickstarter up and going? He's got like just a day on it and only $300.
Christopher, his son, who does a lot for him, has their YouTube channel started.
Yeah.
And there's
with their Hobbit web series.
Yeah, there's talk about a film based on one of his books.
That'd be neat.
So yeah, I heard about that. So I think that's what they're actually raising money for.
And as long as it doesn't include any CGI, I think it'd be fine.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
I think it's gonna have Jim Henson puppets.
If only that were true. Like I've
that would actually be really, really cool.
I've decided
to joke for a second and just talk about that.
Yeah, I've decided to put away all the sarcasm. Sardinism, maybe more accurate. Anyway.
Hedonism?
I'll never put that away. that just reminded me of earlier in this conversation. Never mind.
Take three.
Yeah, take three. Yeah, puppets. Take it away, Aaron.
Next question or next.
All right.
Next comment.
So we're going to move on to comics.
Actually, I would love to work with puppets. I think that would be awesome to do something with puppets.
I think you could be a puppet. I mean, you're a good actor.
Come over here. I don't know, sit you on my knee and
sit on Aaron's knee and let's do
see
a
if I can get you
next, next topic. Now real, that I'm comfortable.
Real quick, before we move away from Vincent's discomfort and before we get away from this topic, you talked a little bit last week about The Dark Crystal. And I was wondering if anybody knew, because as far as I know, it's still in the works.
Tartakovsky is off the project.
For those of you who don't know, there was a Dark Crystal sequel that was in the works, whatever it is, like 18 years, 20 years hence.
Yeah.
And Genndy Tartakovsky, who is the director of and creator, among other things, of Samurai Jack. He worked for a while on Powerpuff Girls and Dexter's Laboratory.
Which is my favorite era of cartoons.
Yeah, so just some really great stuff.
Cartoons.
He was originally slated to direct this film, which is going to be, it's like Jim Henson puppets in CGI environments, which could be totally cool.
Yeah.
But now they have another director signed up for it.
I don't know anything about it.
I think it's gone through a couple.
Tarkovsky was off of it.
Are they still making this thing?
I think so.
I hope so.
I think it might
even be. Even if it's bad, I don't care. Yeah. I'd like to see it.
Hey, that could be your fanboy answer next time. Even if it's bad, that can be the thing.
Yeah.
I
like it when they do. I'm one of the few people, I think, that actually likes all remakes because I like to see a new version of it. And if it sucks, I don't have to ever watch it again.
Like Total Recall?
Yeah, I did watch that, and it did suck.
But there are things you can take away from it, like the hand phone.
Oh, yeah. What? Yeah, the hand phone. They had hand phones. They're built into their hands.
It's integrated. It's like an implant. And his hand.
And they just do a little thing and turn it on and they put their hands on their face.
That's ridiculous.
I want one. Actually,
it's so convenient.
You don't even have
to get a screen protector.
The cell phone that I want is the one from Ultraviolet. Did you guys watch Ultraviolet?
Yeah, I've seen that.
Where it's a card. It's a printed, it's like a printed card that dispenses out of a vending machine.
Yeah.
You put like a. You swipe your credit card and it gives you a phone. Like,
how would you ever take care of any of your sanitary needs if you had a hand phone? I'm sorry, I'm still thinking about the hand phone.
That's what I was wondering.
It's inside. There's no exposed.
Yeah, it's in your hand. It's under your skin.
Right, but what if, like, I misdial people all the time,
while you're wiping your butt?
What about, what about recreational sanitary needs?
Recreational sanitary, like washing your hands multiple times just for fun?
Maybe not sanitary, recreational needs.
This conversation has ended.
High fives?
Anyways,
gentle pats on the back. I don't know what you're getting.
That's fine.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Arm wrestling,
pickpocketing.
Yeah. Okay.
Just put your phone in the hand that you don't wipe your butt with.
Swing and a miss. I use both my hands.
I've got a big butt.
What?
Screw y'all for not laughing at that. That was freaking hilarious.
I was just shocked. I was imagining it in my head.
I'm so glad for editing.
I'm dual wielding.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, so let's talk about comic books. All right, so...
I'm just going to sit back and let y'all take
poop
over.
Talk with the Romantics.
Poop.
Every Wednesday. All right, so we didn't get a whole lot of comic book responses. Apparently, the 200 or 300 people that are watching, listening to our podcast aren't a ton of comic book fans.
When I said that,
maybe the four of us should also answer that question.
I think we shall.
Well, when I said that, I was thinking of like web comics and stuff. That I love web.
Well, those count too.
More than like actual.
Yeah, those count too.
Comics is comics.
Yeah. So we'll go through. I did have somebody who's lately become a very loyal viewer. Derek DeKaiser is his. DeKaiser's his username. Derek is his name. He had a bunch of questions. So what we're gonna do is, we're trying to keep the format down a little shorter than we have been, to make it easier on you guys since we're doing this weekly. So we're gonna do like just a quick, like we're gonna do like a one sentence answer for all these questions, okay? From whoever wants to answer. All right. Yeah. And then we'll talk about comic books, and you can talk about anything that was in here after that. All right.
Do it.
Okay. So, so one of his questions was, and I'm paraphrasing some of these. He said something about nerds that read comics as kids are now Hollywood execs, and is that why there's more comic book movies? So anybody got anything to say about that?
It seems to reason that would make sense,
Dan.
But
yeah, Dan, you got something to say about that, Dan?
Yeah,
go for it.
Excuse me. I think the people that liked comics as kids are now in a position. Mm-hmm. I mean, we grew up, and the fact that a whole generation of people that love those things grew up made it kind of central, because those people now have money to spend.
Right.
Those people are educated about that niche. It's a bigger niche because as adults, we can introduce our kids to those things.
Yeah, we don't get in trouble anymore for liking crazy stuff.
Right. So I think just the simple fact that you like that, a generation of people like that stuff as kids, and then they grew up in a world where media is increasingly important, did totally make that happen. I think that's totally true, and I think it's totally awesome, and I hope they never stop.
Never stop.
Never stop.
T-shirts coming out within the month.
I'm not making that T-shirt. You'll have to find somebody else to do it.
I can make it. It's going to feature Dan on it. And on the back, it's going to say, enjoy.
I'd buy that.
A big picture of Dan on the front with his thumb up saying, never stop under it. And then on the back, on the top, it's going to say, enjoy.
I want the T-shirt that has Aaron with both hands in a giant camera lens that says open the aperture.
Oh my god.
I want one where he's going like this and saying open the aperture.
I think that was take one.
Oh, take one. That was take one.
Oh okay. Yeah.
All right. So the next one from Derek is when you were a kid and you were into comic books. So we're talking like, I don't know, I guess 80s for us.
I didn't 90s. Actually get into comics until I was 18.
Yeah, so well, whenever.
I applaud you.
What actor would you cast in a movie as a comic book character that you like?
Jeez. Oh, I had to think. Surprisingly, I've pretty much been happy for every comic book movie I've seen. I've enjoyed the person who plays it.
The casting choices.
Yeah. There hasn't ever really been one that I can think of.
Well, what about a comic character that you enjoy that hasn't had a movie made about them? Like maybe Dawson from Dawson's Creek playing Booster Gold
at his current age.
Oh man, I have to go come back to me.
I've got one.
Go
for it.
Yeah,
this probably would have worked better when he was a little bit younger, but here's my reasoning. Guy Pearce is like a way better and not now fat Val Kilmer, and I think Val Kilmer played a pretty good blind guy in that movie with Mira Sorvino. There's a weird non sequitur in that movie that I really want to talk about later if we have time.
Yeah.
Or maybe another episode. Just remind me. And so I think that Guy Pearce, who I already really like, would be a pretty outstanding Daredevil.
That would be sweet.
And I think Guy Pearce is awesome.
People that react, there will be people that will react with Daredevil sucks, but that's because they saw the movie with Ben Affleck.
Yeah, that movie wasn't good.
And it's completely true. That movie was horrible.
But and I hated Bullseye in that movie too. He just irritated me. I think it's because
everything about that movie was bad.
It's because I don't like that actor though. Yeah. Like he always seems
like Colin Farrell?
he always seems like he's a punk in everything, even when he's not supposed to be a punk.
There is the In Bruges.
In Bruges, yeah.
Seven Psychopaths.
Good movie.
Both. That's, I love
Colin There's Farrell. A lot of movies I haven't seen with him in it that I've heard are good, but it's Colin Farrell just turns me
any,
off.
Any eyebrow work I do is based off Colin Farrell. I watch Colin Farrell movies for his eyebrows.
Do you sit around and like stroke your forehead and pretend like you're Bullseye sometimes, just like he did?
I feel like Colin Farrell didn't get it for a while and he really sucked. And then sometime after his ascent to popularity, like, he got it, and now
maybe that's what it is. Although I saw him in that Terminator, I mean, in that Total Recall movie, and it may have just been because the movie sucked.
It was the movie,
but I still get this, like, and he may be like this in real life, and maybe that's why I can see it. I get this mischievous sort of like thing from his expressions and stuff all the time that kind of turns me off.
I feel like
he when buys too much into himself or something.
I don't know. No, I don't think it's a selfish thing. I think
it's his eyebrows. When I look at him, I feel like he's always about to ask a question.
Yeah, that makes sense. I can see that.
And that can kill it for me. But
wasn't he in Phone Booth? Was that him?
I liked Phone Booth.
I thought that was a really stupid concept.
I didn't see
it. I liked it. It is directed by the same guy that did Flatliners and Batman.
That's about a guy that's stuck in a phone booth for the whole movie, right?
Yes. But, it's a Schumacher.
For the record, Flatliners is badass.
Flatliners is awesome. I actually own that movie. It's awesome.
Yeah, it's
Flatliners, ladies and gentlemen. If you take nothing else away from this cast and if you've lasted this long, Flatliners.
It's a good one. It's a good one.
It sucks a little bit.
Okay, so
awesome. F you.
So what's his name? Guy Pearce's Daredevil. You got one here?
Who Andy from The Office? What's his real name?
Shoot.
I just watched him on a show. I just watched him on Comedy Bang Bang's TV show, actually, and
doggone it.
Can't remember his name now.
Anyway, I would choose him for my favorite superhero, golden age version of, or bronze age.
Silver.
Screwed that up. Silver yeah. Age version.
The Purple Age version.
Ted Kord as
Beetle Blue. Blue Beetle. Sorry.
So, for the record, the Night Owl from mm-hmm. Watchmen is based on the Silver Age Blue Beetle, correct? Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So he's kind of a gadgety, tinkery guy. I can kind of see that because he's kind of a nerd who gets opportunity to be an adventurer.
Right, he's not a lady killer. He's got the right head shape for it. I'd like to see him in some yellow goggles.
You'd like to see everyone in yellow goggles.
Absolutely. I definitely would not. If I was producing that, I would
Ed
not
Helms.
Let... Ed Helms, thank you. I would not let them update the suit, though. It would have to be exactly like it was from the comic.
It's actually not a bad costume.
It's my favorite. It's so dorky, but so awesome.
Is that the costume that has the giant eyeball
Yeah, it's the
goggles?
Giant yellow
like, It's just goggles. Like a bubble. Just like a bubble.
And then he has a big... pattern
okay thing. Yeah
did you ever see the picture I took of my brother-in-law Jeff and I turned him into the Blue Beetle just
yes.
threw on top of
yeah.
him
yeah. yeah
that was
yeah.
hilarious
really funny
it was like I you and him, you and him and or you and Rob made one of somebody too
no I did versions of everybody
weren't you Green Arrow
No, I did Green Lantern. I made myself Green Lantern.
Oh, Green Lantern.
Are those still on your MySpace, Aaron?
I think they are still on my MySpace.
That MySpace. Everybody's going to go try to look it up.
Oh,
now.
My gosh. You can't delete MySpace, can you?
Yeah, you can.
Okay, we got to delete that before this airs.
We don't. No, we don't. Don't
oh
do it.
Gosh. I'm pretty sure all of MySpace is deleted anyways.
I have a MySpace music page.
Oh, my gosh.
No, nobody can find it because it has a band name and no one knows what it is.
Nice.
Oh, I'll figure it out.
I must find this.
Playing guitar and singing.
Oh my gosh.
What? That's so weird.
How did we reveal all this about ourselves?
Wait a second. So we've got Daredevil, we've got Blue Beetle.
Mm-hmm. I'm still trying to think.
I got one.
I can't think of anything.
Mine, you guys are like yours. Mine is cheating. You don't know what it is.
We need to have a girl.
You read it?
Yeah, I already read.
Did I write something down?
Yeah, you did.
I did? Hold on, let me see. What did I write down? I didn't write
Maybe that wasn't yours.
That's not mine. That was De Kaiser's.
Oh, okay.
De Kaiser said Arnold for Colossus. Mm-hmm. That's what he said. Mine is Christopher Reeve as Superman.
Oh, my gosh.
I'm going to have to ask you to leave.
Okay, I have to say, a lot of people don't understand. No, a lot of people don't understand why I like Superman, and I like Superman because of Christopher Reeve's Superman. Because Superman, to me, everybody always complains about Superman because he's invincible, typically. You know, he's like a stupid superhero because, you know, he's like, he can do anything. He's like a god, basically. And that's the reason a lot of people cite that they don't like Superman, because it's boring because of that. But my whole infatuation with Superman throughout my life has been because of the whole White Knight thing, you know, like, and they've changed that in comics a lot, which ruins Superman to me.
To me, he's perfect. He doesn't have a flaw, and I just can't deal with
it. Well, he does have flaws. He has a lot of flaws. And if you go back and watch the Christopher Reeve Supermans, they're very heavily displayed in those movies.
He's too good.
he basically struggles with that all the time, and he does do things wrong. He just doesn't murder people and stuff like that, and he tries not to lie about anything. And, you know, Superman started off as like a vigilante punk that just beat up dudes in the street. That's what he started off as.
You've said that, but dude, I cannot find evidence of that, and I've looked.
Go watch there's a thing on Netflix that it has the entire history of Superman from the beginning to the end. And it describes like the 7 or 8 different eras of Superman.
Who's the creator of Superman?
Schuster and Siegel.
Yeah, Schuster.
They're
I had Schumacher in my head. I was like, not Schumacher. That guy's a race car driver.
They're two Canadian guys, and I've actually read Action Comics number 1 from 1938. Oh. And he never goes through a vigilante phase in that issue.
That's what I'm saying.
There's a thing. I'm gonna have to get that episode out, or find out what the name of that thing is, and let you guys watch it. It might be something about when they were starting to write it. That's what they were originally intending to write it as.
You said this is on Netflix,
huh?
You said we should be able to find it on Netflix once we know.
Yeah.
That. Okay. Cool.
There's like three things on Netflix about Superman, and one of them is a thing that it actually looks like a black and white film, but it's not. Hmm. The cover of it does. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'll definitely check that out.
But anyway. I don't know. To me, the whole Superman thing is supposed to be the fight for good kind of mentality or whatever. And I just don't like the fact that they changed all of that into... I mean, Superman's gone through all this like crazy crap at this point.
Every comic book character has.
You know, and there's all these alternate versions and all this crazy stuff now, which is weird.
Well, that's DC.
I know. So it's like, I don't know. Superman ended for me with Christopher Reeve's Superman. And then the new Superman movie that they made with Brandon Routh, that's his name, right?
Mm-hmm.
Brandon? Okay.
Yeah.
Brandon Routh. I actually liked it. It's not an amazing film, but I think the reason that I liked it is because they tried to make it a throwback to Christopher Reeve's Superman movies. There's a whole lot of references in there to that movie, right. And they just kind of pay homage to it to a certain extent.
Well, what's his name? Bryan Singer said that he got the okay from the studio to consider it in the same universe, and he said that it was his jumping off point was Superman 2. He said it was as though it went from Superman 1 and 2 to Superman Returns.
Yeah, Superman 3 was retarded.
Superman 3 was retarded, and then Superman 4.
Oh, gosh. I've only seen Superman 4
once. Is that the one with the space whales?
This guy has the power to make his fingernails grow, stuff like
that. Oh, yeah. It's bad.
Yeah.
I have it in there. I have, like, the old Reeves collection.
Yeah, thing. I've seen that.
And I've watched, I have that, and I've loved Superman all my life, and I've still only watched 4 once, and that was more than enough.
It's probably one of my favorite theme songs, though. I love that.
Do it for us real quick.
Oh my gosh.
I love it.
I think that was it.
It's pretty epic.
But I have an answer, though. It's nothing that I would replace, but what I would like to see, just from thinking about it, what I'd really like to see, I think would be interesting, is he was, his name, his Green Goblin, he was in...
James Franco?
No.
His dad, right?
Willem Dafoe as the Joker. Because he has the face of Satan.
Hey, I don't know.
I think, well, here's what I think about that. I think Willem Dafoe.
Where are you, Dan?
I think Willem Dafoe is such a good actor that he could probably make Joker pretty awesome if they could paint him up right.
Willem Dafoe is pretty good.
Have you seen him play a woman?
Well, have you seen him in Wild at Heart? I'd like to.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Wild at Heart is amazing.
He is the nastiest living being alive in all of living in that movie.
So what's our next comment or all right, question?
Let's see. The next thing on the comic book list is, are you happy that Marvel got the rights back for Daredevil and Blade? I think Dan has some good stuff to say about this, because didn't you say Daredevil's your favorite?
Daredevil was one. I read the Brian Michael Bendis Daredevil comics in the 2000s, and they reinvigorated the comics for me. It's a crime comic. It basically starts with Matt Murdock, who is Daredevil, who's a blind defense attorney, being outed to
the FBI and everybody as being this costume vigilante, but they don't have like, they don't have hard evidence. They have everything but hard evidence. So it's basically him having to deal with all these things in his personal life that comes from that, as well as like constant assassination attempts, because now everybody knows who he is and where he lives, and ex-girlfriends like showing up to deal with this in various ways. But also, I mean, the FBI is monitoring his house all the time, and he's monitoring them, and the people that he loves and cares about are all in danger, and some of them die, and some of them, you know, have to go away. And it was just, it was awesome. And so from that, I went back and read like some of the Frank Miller, I'm having a problem. Sorry. some of the Frank Miller Daredevil comics from back in the day. And they're really good. Just about the, it's Daredevil is, it's a comic book that takes place largely in the slums of New York. And it's this, this bottom of the barrel of the Marvel universe. And it's kind of, Matt Murdock could, he's extremely talented and he's a really capable defense attorney and he could be anything, but he stays in his situation and he protects the people that he does for two reasons. One is to look out for people that can't take care of themselves. But the other is because he's constantly punishing himself, because he's the most guilt ridden, just, he's a special kind of crazy. Like as OCD and controlling as Batman is, that's how guilty Matt Murdock is, and it's one of his biggest motivating factors. And to me, that's really believable. Like just that, I've always kind of associated any kind of realistic superhero comic book scenario with a degree of mental illness. Because come on, guys,
yeah,
who are these people that put on? I mean, in The Watchmen, when they explore that relationship, and like that's how those people become comfortable with themselves and comfortable with each other, like sexually, mm-hmm. and all of those things, it's because they have a problem.
Yeah. It doesn't make sense. Like it's, nobody's that selfless to, you know, just, yes, I misspoke. There are people out there that selfless, but it's not natural.
Right. I mean, there's Superman. He's that selfless.
But he's awesome.
But yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, he's a really complex character and there were so many things going on in that.
See, I'm exactly what you said about Daredevil and other comic book characters sometimes too, as I don't like him because of that movie. And because I never really read any Daredevil stuff.
And that movie ruined it. God awful.
Aesthetically though, his costume is one of the coolest out there.
Oh, yeah. I think you talking about in the comics or in that show?
In the comics. The
comics.
Okay, I was about to say, in the show, Ben Affleck looks really strange in that suit. he looks like a fish out of water completely.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And the top part of it and Ben Affleck's face coming down the bottom part of it. The first time I ever saw that, I thought, that is ridiculous looking.
Yeah, it looks really bad. And it's leather.
We'll never get Ben Affleck to listen to this podcast.
Sorry, Ben Affleck.
Well, not with that.
This has nothing to do with Ben Affleck.
What?
I said this has nothing to do with Ben Affleck.
I seriously think that the way that movie... We are saying a lot of negative things about this movie.
It was a bad movie.
Yes.
It was a bad movie.
Real quick, just off topic, side note. Does anybody else find that these pop filters serve as really great bad breath collectors?
No, I think they just smelled really weird beforehand. I think
they just smell weird.
Mine smells different now.
This smells tangier.
Take a sip of water. Let's move on here. One last thing from DeKaiser, and then we'll just do some random talking about comics for a bit. He wanted to ask the question. Do you consider any comic books actual literature? I think some are.
Well, Time Magazine has a list of 100 best novels in the English language, and The Watchmen is on that list. So, I think that there are.
So, do you think only big graphic novels count?
No. I mean, I want to clarify for people, I'm a person that reads books, and that I like, and they're not just fantasy and science fiction novels, although I do like those things. But, you know, fiction and literature are important to me. So, you know, comics, to me, I feel like comics and anime are like a summer blockbusters. I mean, there's so much out there and it's 98% crap.
Right.
There's so much junk out there. So it's difficult to talk to people that don't have any knowledge of this and say that, yeah, there's stuff out there that's really, really good. Because I mean, I always just feel like I'm making an ass of myself because obviously like everything that you're confronted with all the time is just junk.
Right. It's the same thing with fantasy and sci-fi books though. If you go to a bookstore or
that's true.
And you just look through those things, there's a lot of crap.
I think with books though, it takes enough effort that people are like, well, at least you're reading.
Yeah. Well, comics also have a very strict schedule. They're supposed to get those things. I don't remember what their timeline is, but they're supposed to be cranking those things out.
Are most comic book series weekly?
Most of them are monthly.
Okay, that's what I thought.
They
do a whole bunch at one time from the same.
Right. Right. And they're also storylines are determined by producer. Like who's in charge of Marvel?
They have an editor in chief, and then they have there's different structures for different companies, but a lot of them have editors who are in charge of the overarching story for like a property.
Right.
Like there's a person, like there's a mutant editor at Marvel who makes sure that all the X-Men books are in line and that they're dealing with the
same issues. That sounds like a magazine company.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they have the same roots.
Yeah. So it sounds like, I mean, to me, it sounds like the way they run a magazine company got different editors for different.
Yeah.
Fun fact, for all you Pet Shop Boys fans out there, Neil from the Pet Shop Boys used to be an editor for Marvel Comics in the UK before he got started as an amazing recording artist with a beautiful voice.
I think that anything that has a written word on it can be considered literature. Well, I think it depends on like who it comes from and what the purpose is and if people are getting something out of it.
I have an example that I would consider up there. Oh, I'm sorry.
What? No, go for it.
No.
I looked like... I think I know what you're going to say, Aaron, and I'm excited.
Okay.
No, you go.
Well,
No, you go.
Well, I was just going to say that I think it's close to the same argument if, you know, our comic books literature is our video games art. And it's, you know, for us, a lot of it is, but if you get to like people who just don't read it, don't really understand anything about it, it comes off as, no, these are just pure entertainment value.
Yeah, we had a huge argument in my stream about whether video games were art like a month ago. Mm-hmm. And I basically said that maybe some are, but I don't think all of them are.
Right, which is how I feel about comics and graphic novels and most of those type of things.
I mean, if you put something, in my opinion, if you put something out for the sole reason to make a ton of cash and there's no kind of like heart and soul put into it, it's not art. It's not expressionism, it's cash grabbing.
Yeah, and I will say that because there are so many niches in literature and there are so many different types of people and so many different things that you can appeal to, and there are so many influences and so many communities to pander to. I mean, some of it's entertainment value, but also a lot of it is, you know, academic. There are people that pander to critics over fans and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then that I think that because anything can happen in the book's format, that especially with POD or publish on demand books, which is where they actually just print a copy, usually with some kind of crappy binding, and they send it to you if you order it. Otherwise, it doesn't get published in large volumes. Books can be made for any audience, but with video games and with comic books and with movies and these other types of media, they have to get the biggest and most secure target market possible. So it kind of has to be a cash grab or it's not going to happen.
Yeah.
Right.
And it's not going to enable them to produce their next product.
Right, but you probably wouldn't argue that something like Call of Duty is art.
I would not argue for Call of Duty being art.
But you might for something like Skyrim or something like that has more artistic scenery.
I've never encountered a video game that I would consider art.
I think
Castlevania is awesome.
You know what I said? There are some games now that are coming out that I do consider completely art, like Journey and a couple of these little indie games that are like these visual experiences. Those are art. They're solid art. There's nothing else to them.
What? I mean, that's a different
like a regular video game. There's no video game out there that I consider the whole entire product a piece of art either. I do think there are some things in it that could be considered art on its own. Like
some of the most well respected art that we know of today was made for money. Like they did it as a job.
I'm talking besides the fact of money. I'm talking about just if I look at something and it's something that a team of 30 people hacked together, I don't consider that art.
I also don't consider a lot of the things that you're probably talking about art.
Well, yeah, art's different for every person. I think the greatest factor that kind of contributes to whether or not something is art is time and like opinion that you know, helps.
Yeah, we did. We did come to the conclusion that you can really only define art for yourself,
right?
Because that's what art's about in the first place.
It is a fun conversation, but it
has no solution.
Yeah, I mean, simply trying to, it's a conversation that helps you discover a little bit about yourself.
I do want to get back to the question though of is there a comic book that you guys, either of you guys, think would consider literature?
I consider. I'm sorry, but I have to say it real quick. Grant Morrison's Seven Soldiers. Freaking awesome.
Yeah, it's really awesome. And it's definitely, I mean, it's definitely very much in a comic book universe that already stands, but it's about kind of that good versus evil struggle, but it reaches really far and it approaches a lot of different angles, and it capitalizes on the medium in like every way.
He uses a different artist for each. Seven Soldiers is a series, as a mini series. What do they call it? Maxi series? I don't know.
That sounds like a feminine care product.
Anyway, it's a series that has, it starts with issue zero. It's the bookend to the series, and it ends with issue number one. And all of everything in between focuses on one of the seven soldiers.
There are seven 4-issue limited series.
Yes.
And they all form one complete story.
Right. And yeah, some of them are better than others, but there was a series that totally wrinkled my brain and made me think about media in a different way. And it was, I can't remember the character's name. It might just be the Bulleteer or the Silver Bullet.
Oh, the Bulleteer.
Okay. Yeah. So that character, her origin is she's just a wife to, a scientist who's developing some compound. You don't really know what it is, I don't think, when it starts off, but he's sneaking up in the middle of the night to basically have online affairs with women that pose as superheroes.
Yeah, or have some
video chat rooms.
Yeah, or have some kind of superhero alter ego, whether they are one or consider themselves one, or they just dress up as one on a webcam.
He's got this secret fetish that he chooses not to share with his wife, and he makes it a secret part of his life. And one night something happens and he ends up like the compound, like while he's having this online affair, the compound like gets released on him or something. And it like,
I think he just got excited enough to like try to use it.
Oh yeah, that's right. He was going to dress up himself, trying to create it. He's turned himself into a superhero, and it was an alloy that would infuse itself with the skin, and it infused itself with every tissue in his body and like choked him out and killed him.
I would compare it to the same compound that transformed the Molten Man.
I just laugh like I know what's going on.
And so his wife walks in. His wife walks in, sees what's happened, like runs over to his body and tries to like help him. She's holding him, and the compound spreads on her, but for some reason doesn't kill her. So she's transformed into the superhero. The thing that wrinkled my brain was that it was presenting this ugliness of this relationship and of this man and his attraction to these superhero or these women dressing up as superheroes, but he got an artist to draw it that specialized in very buxom ladies. And so you were kind of forced into that role of the husband, like where you,
I think we already are right. Supposed to be that role. But, like the husband is exposing comic book fans that love the big breasted comic book ladies and that whole like sexualization.
Yeah. And it's a disgusting
female characters.
The image and the what happens is like terrible and dark and disgusting, but at the same time everybody's drawn really attractively. So it just causes like this really weird
feeling.
And I would consider anything that causes a reaction like that in a person to be literature. I mean, that's written by somebody in an effective way.
That's probably legit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if it causes, yeah, I mean, even if it's bad, if it causes a reaction in you like that, I'm not talking about bad, like, oh, I hate this thing. I mean, like,
sure,
it causes an emotional response of any kind, then somebody did something that worked.
Oh, man.
Or had some kind of value to it in some way or another.
I think everybody out there should go pick that series up.
What's it called again?
In trade paperback form.
Seven Soldiers.
Yeah, Seven Soldiers.
It also has by far the most insidious, like, underlying evil force of any like kind of comic book or science fiction or fantasy scenario ever. Like the antagonists or antagonist are just so ridiculously evil.
Yeah.
It's like, it's sickening and horrible and it's awesome.
Yep. Huge payoff. So many little details in the drawings. Things constantly cross over and reference one another. It's like,
yeah, it's one of those things you'll
so
read
dense
many times and you'll get something different out of it.
I'm going to go get them out of my attic when I get home.
Vincent, you got one that you consider?
Well, I consider literature, not a whole lot that I've read, but with your definition of ones that have like gotten big emotional responses, Alan Moore's A Killing Joke was one that I was just like,
whoa. Yeah. Yep. Pretty much anything Alan Moore, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, I was thinking about it last night. I was looking on my shelf what I had.
Explain the synopsis a little bit without spoilers.
I'm trying to remember. It's been a couple years since I read it, but it's Joker and the Batman, and it was from what I remember, it plays the Joker as this not so much as like a chaotic person, but as just like an evil person. And, yeah. And it plays a big almost not even juxtaposed, but just like this. It relates Batman's darkness to the Joker's.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying.
It's pretty intense.
Cool.
But
and what's it called?
The Killing Joke.
Cool.
Yeah.
I actually prefer the super nasty evil Joker to the more comical one.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. The only version of the Joker that's not totally disgusting that I can think of is the Batman the Animated
Series.
Well,
some of them.
The Bold.
Some of the joke, I'm talking like all media combined, there's a lot of Jokers that are really goofy instead of insidious.
Yeah. I think we all know that Mark Hamill is the voice of the Joker in Batman the Animated Series, and I think he did a pretty phenomenal job in that role. In Young Justice, which is a more current DC animated series, the Joker is voiced by Brent Spiner, who played Lieutenant Commander Data.
Believe it or not, we have this discussion in my chat about once every 2 weeks.
Really?
Yeah, because Mark Hamill's played the Joker in tons of video games.
Right. He did it for Arkham City
and
Arkham Asylum.
He did that thing where he said, "I'm never doing this again," or whatever. I'm done with it. And
he
freaked
left to do
out
cock
about
knocker.
It. Yeah, he left cock blocker.
What's
cock knocker. Cock knocker, yeah.
Yeah, the big fist.
So if anybody gets that reference, post a comment.
Shame on you.
That super famous voice actor, he did Gears of War, Adventure Time. What's his name? Big guy.
I don't know his name.
What was your question?
The voice actor, he's really famous. He did Gears of War, Adventure Time.
What character in Adventure Time?
Jake.
I know who you're talking about. I can't think of his name.
Big guy.
Yeah, the voice of Jake is the guy that does Bender.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can't think of his name, but same guy.
Same guy. He did the Joker in one series. It was really good.
So we got about, we got about 10 minutes left. You guys want to talk about any comic stuff? Favorite comics, maybe?
Dan, are you currently reading anything?
I'm currently reading some books, but I'm not really reading any comics actively. I recently read... I recently got caught up on the X-Men, what's going on with the X-Men right now. And it's pretty interesting. Like, it kind of casts, there's been like a schism, and Cyclops is now this Malcolm Xavier kind of figure that's like really, really, this really revolutionary and is, like confronting authorities sometimes with violence when they're trying to contain like mutant threats in inhumane ways and that kind of thing, and they just show up places and grab people and disappear, and everyone else, of course, the Wolverine side of that. I feel super nerdy talking about this. My old fears and anxiety return.
Why?
Because it's the X-Men, man. Everybody knows who the X-Men are.
I've always been a DC guy, but when I was a kid, I only watched X-Men cartoons, as far as comic book cartoons.
Well, I don't think there was anything else.
There was a few things, but they weren't any good.
Batman?
There was Batman.
Batman the Animated Series didn't come on until after the X-Men set.
It was before. Batman the Animated Series? Yeah. So Batman the Animated Series came out shortly after the Tim Burton movie, which was in 1989.
Whoa, I did not realize that.
And then X-Men started in 1992.
Yeah. Three. And the, like, that's the first, I didn't get maybe to read, 92. I never got to read comic books. Aaron had some comic books when I was young. I was already older.
I had a subscription to Amazing Spider-Man.
Yeah, I never got to read comic books. And we would go and buy a couple comic books every once in a while, yeah. But we weren't like, I don't know. I didn't have access to them.
We always bought like crazy, gross, Valiant comics.
I bought copy number one of the Savage Dragon.
Mm. Hey, me too. Mm. Me too, man.
It looked cool.
It was savage.
Yes, it was. I mean, that dude was like big and stuff.
Yeah.
Who's the artist on Savage Dragon?
Eric Larson.
It was like the Incredible Hulk, but a dragon.
Not the same Eric Larson that does that comic.
Oh yeah, that guy.
The Far Side, isn't that also an Eric Larson?
Far Side.
No.
Who am I thinking of?
It's Gary.
Yes. Gary Larson.
Yeah.
Okay.
Far Side is awesome.
Yeah.
So pretty good.
Was it? Was there a comic Youngblood? Was that Rob Liefeld?
Yeah.
I was huge into. Actually, I'm finally getting back into some Rob Liefeld comics. I'm a huge fan.
Are you being serious with us right now?
No, I'm trying to get you off. I'm trying to draw you offside.
You're trying to get me off by talking about Rob.
He's trying to virtually tweak your nipples.
Oh, yeah. I think we recently talked about...
We talk about him all the time.
How his feet... He draws feet that look like blades.
Yeah. And how many teeth does he usually include in a head?
Wow. So many teeth.
That sounds amazing.
There's a
Where can I find some of his artwork? Which comic?
All over the place. There's a great little website that dissects his images and his character design. Oh, yeah, it's super hilarious.
I would like to shout out some amazing web content. Oh yeah, favorite comic there. Yes. Okay, one of the best comics I've ever read, and one that I would recommend to everyone that likes comics and anyone that doesn't like comics or doesn't care or whatever. I mean. Is Scott McCloud's Understanding Comics.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's all about the visual language and how comics work, how they relate to your brain.
Real quick before you move on, that's really interesting because Rob made a post one time on Facebook, Polifka, about comics and how he said something about kind of like what you're saying about how they, some comic he was talking, kind of reviewing shortly. And I responded to that, I think, and I said, I've never in my life thought of a comic book in that way, and now it makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Because I've always wondered, like, how can you read a comic? It's got like 10 words in it, you know?
Well, in 1997, Rob Polifka, can I say names?
Yeah.
I just said
as names. Long as it's not bad.
Go ahead and edit that.
Rob listens.
A guy I
Hello,
know.
Hello, Rob.
A guy I know. Hey. Never stop.
Hi, brother.
Hey, brother.
That reminds me, I could really go for a massage right about now. Who else could go for a shoulder rub?
I don't have a hook.
Oh, no, left my hook. I just watched that episode last night where they're trying to massage around each other.
Oh yeah, amazing. Oh. Such a good show.
Yes.
All right, we gotta stop talking about that show.
All right, so the comic series.
Oh yeah, he loaned that comic to me many years ago, and it seriously, one, it changed my perception, not just about comics, but it's really good book about just how we perceive and understand things, how your brain processes information, why you like things. But it's also, it is a comic book. It's told in comic book format, and it's really interesting. It's pretty thick. Like it's...
I like them thick.
It's good. And after I borrowed that from Rob, I bought two copies, one for myself and then one to give away.
That's awesome.
Oh, I'm going to have to go look that up. What's it called again? I'm going to actually write that down for real.
It's Understanding Comics, and it's by Scott McCloud, who, what reminded me of this...
Every half-price book has four or five.
Yeah, they tend to. He has some other books in the same series, but it's the blue one. It's really good. But he has a really amazing website as well that's like... Or maybe... I don't know. It's like infinite... Cool. You'll just have to see it. It's I don't know if he's changed it. Originally, it was designed so that you could click on any of these many small parts of the website and it would just magnify it. So it was like you're infinitely zooming in.
Oh, cool.
And it was really, really neat.
All right.
Well, speaking of web comics real fast, I'm really excited. Hyperbole and a Half came back yesterday.
I saw your post on Facebook about that.
I'm super excited. Ali Barrage came back after 18 months to finally start writing some more.
I so cried. That was a rough read.
Yeah. It was pretty brutal.
Oh, I need to go read it now. I didn't actually read it.
I bawled, dude.
Yeah. And that's what I'm most excited for right now. But
Yeah, that's new, at least coming back.
Cool. Check it out.
But yeah,
she's incredible.
It's
Dan, you never actually said.
So funny.
Did you actually say what your favorite comic was?
I just did.
Understand, did you?
Understanding that one? Comics.
Okay,
yeah.
That's it.
That's right. Aaron?
My favorite comic? I think it would be Seven Soldiers. Okay. Just that entire run. Cool. I like Blue Beetle a lot, but just purely for aesthetics.
Yeah, mine would be The Tick. No, I'm kidding. I actually like that show, though.
Spoon.
Man, that tick is awesome. I mean, that tick. Yes, that show is hilarious to me. It's the so live fast. Action.
Maybe later. If you give me a shoulder rub.
Okay.
Oh, man. Okay.
Deal.
So I think for this week, the question for this week is going to be whatever you want. So I'm going to pose like a little scenario. I'm going to pose a little scenario for you. And what, you guys got something different?
I had a question that I wanted to ask our viewers.
Yeah, go for it.
One of the things, we talked about this a little bit, and our listeners, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to leave you guys out. We're looking at a camera here.
Yeah,
so we
know it's confusing.
They have to look at something when they're listening, so technically.
True.
Our peeps.
Yeah. Yeah, our homeboys and girls.
And slices.
One of the most challenging things about having a web series, in fact, we talked about this recently, maybe the most challenging, is getting the word out, getting people to look at this content who have never seen it before, never heard of it before, getting people to, I mean, I have a hard time getting people to share the content on Facebook.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, usually when I share it on, or when I put it on Facebook, it gets like 2 shares.
Yeah. And that's really discouraging because I think that, I mean, hopefully those of you who have watched The Romantics like it. I mean, I really love it. I loved it before I was involved. And I think it's a really good program and I think that it's going to just get better and better. And I think that, like this podcast is really entertaining. And I think that it's, I mean, we've got a lot of positive feedback on the podcast. It's really fun to do. We have a lot of other projects going on. I mean, obviously these guys have the Man Boy Adventure Show and we have, pardon me, Pen and Paper coming out, eventually one of these days, hopefully. But if any of you have any ideas on how we can, expose this to more people or expose more people to ourselves.
Fully clothed.
Yeah, just a media type of exposure. But if you have any ideas on how we can get the word out, how we can make it more exciting for people to want to share content and
maybe segments. Help us, I don't know, just content. Anything. It's, yeah. Anybody out there that's a social media pro, I do my best, but I admit I don't.
Yeah,
I'm learning. I've never ever participated in social media. I didn't grow up in the social media era. It's all new to me. I'm trying to figure it out. It's,
and we do have some other things that we want to do. I mean, a lot of it's just shameless self promotion and getting things out in print. If there's anything that you guys can recommend to us, that'd be awesome.
And then as far as general questions go, here's what I would like you guys to do if you want to participate this week. I want you to start a conversation in a comment about a topic and we will finish it on the podcast.
Boom.
Okay. Cool. And as talking about go ahead, Vincent. Talking about promotion, Aaron, show that.
Okay.
For the viewers anyway.
This week I was working on getting the season 1 DVD artwork finalized, and I got a little prototype finished up that I'm going to be giving to somebody I know, see what they think. But then we're also going to get a couple of these tweaked up and ready to send out to people in the industry. Maybe they'll peek at it and say, "Hey, that was good," and
flip it.
Give us an email.
The back is going to change a little bit
on the back.
But yeah.
Yeah. So I'm gonna hold this up for the viewers. Somebody else talk while I go hold this up.
Yeah, so if you guys are listening watch your headset. Yeah. If you guys are listening to this instead of watching it on YouTube, you can go to YouTube and sort of just click toward the end of the video and have a look at it if you want to see what it looks like.
Yeah, you can skip all the CRAP and go right to the good stuff.
Do we have crap? No.
No, we got rid of that before the show started.
Content in really awesome podcast, CRAP.
Oh, that was a good save.
How do you guys not know that? This is podcasting 101, y'all.
It's a no-brainer.
Oh, I like that. I'm impressed. Okay. I'm very impressed.
Good.
All right, so
I wish you hadn't said that you wanted before, because I would have been more impressed.
I want to end this on a little comment that we had from Idiot. That's his username. I'm not calling him an idiot.
He's a cool guy.
He's a really cool guy, and he helps me out a ton on Twitch. He posted his favorite author as Martin Hanford, and here's what he had to say. Martin Hanford is most noted for his series of books about the arduous search for an elusive man in varying different vivid scenarios. When you pick his books up, you just can't put it back down until you've completed it. And so I read that, and I was like, oh, that sounds interesting.
I went and looked it up on Wikipedia, and he was talking about Where's Wally or Where's Waldo. So thanks, idiot. Appreciate that. that was a good synopsis, though. I mean, you made it sound pretty awesome.
Yeah, he should put that on his book.
Yes, he does. He needs to put that there. Yes. All right, so we're gonna kill this here. No, it's not dead. It's coming back. Okay, so we'll be back next Wednesday. Thank you guys for hanging out with us, and we'll see you next week.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thanks, y'all.
Bye.